Welcome to this NPTEL course, namely Real Analysis. This is the course which we shall be giving, Real Analysis. And maybe I should begin by saying that this is a very basic course. If you take any MSc program anywhere in the world, this Real Analysis will be one of the core courses in this. Real Analysis and Linear Algebra, these two form a very pair of very basic courses in every MSc program all over the world. And whatever course you do after this, that is say differential equations or functional analysis or topology or complex analysis, all those courses require concept from the Real Analysis. And what do you do basically in Real Analysis? Whatever you have learned in calculus, concepts like function, continuity, differentiability, integrability, we look at those concepts more closely, more rigorously in this course. And there is one more thing, it is that this is a course which gives more importance to proofs. Unlike for example something like a differential equation course where you are where usually more stress is given to solve the equations and find the solutions, etc. Here there are very few things where you solve anything. Main thing to do in Real Analysis is to learn some new concepts and prove things. And while talking about the proofs, let me also mention here that something that is said by Simmons, that when you look at the proof of a theorem will consist of two parts. There will be some hypothesis and some conclusions. And the idea of a theorem is to start from the conclusion and go to start from the hypothesis and go to the conclusion. And this may be done in a number of steps. So suppose you understand each step, let us say how you know how to go from say jth step to j plus 1 step for each j, that does not really mean that you have understood the proof completely. The main idea of the proof you may still not have understood. So when do you really know that you understood the proof of the theorem? It means that you have to understand the proof as one single idea, or what is the main idea in the proof. Then you have to ask questions like, suppose you drop some hypothesis in the theorem, will the conclusion still remain valid? And now how does one say such a thing? Arguments like this particular proof doesn't work will not be a complete answer to that, because even if that particular proof doesn't work, some other proof may work. So questions like this can be decided only by giving a counter example. What is meant by a counter example again here? That it is an example in which except that one particular hypothesis, all other hypotheses should be true, but the conclusion is false. Okay, so that only will prove that that particular hypothesis is essential for proving that theorem. Okay. So these are the kind of things which are very important in Real Analysis. Okay. Let me also mention a couple of books that we shall be following. The one book is by Walter Rudin, Principles of Mathematical Analysis. And we will also occasionally see the book by Simmons, G.F. Simmons. Okay, title is Introduction to Topology and Modern Analysis. And Modern Analysis. One of the basic difference between the calculus and analysis is that in calculus one is usually concerned with one function and properties of that function and what happens to that functions. In analysis we usually deal with classes of functions, various species of functions, and in particular one of the objects that we shall be studying is what are called metric spaces. Now before proceeding with those things, let us fix some notations which we shall be using throughout this course. Okay. Of course you may have already used that notation, but it is better that to fix them once for all. Okay, this is n, the set of all natural numbers. Set of all natural numbers. Okay. That is natural numbers. That is the numbers like 1, 2, 3, etc. Okay. Then this is Z, the set of all integers. Okay, the set of all integers. That is the natural numbers. Then 0 and then -1, -2, etc. Okay. Then Q, the set of all complex numbers, not complex numbers, set of all rational numbers. Okay. By the way, let me mention here that this symbol is, for example, this is n with just one vertical bar here, or similarly z with another bar here, etc. These are basically devised so that we can use the usual letters n, z, etc. in as other symbols. So this is like freezing of that particular symbol. This is read as blackboard n. Similarly, blackboard z, etc. That means n with this another extra bar here. Similarly, this R, blackboard R. Okay, that is the set of all real numbers. Okay, and also we may not use this set very often, but okay, this is C, the set of all complex numbers. Okay, this is, these are the notations for these sets which we shall be using throughout. Okay, right. Then we shall now begin with, because as every such course in real analysis and for example every elementary course in mathematics requires various operations with sets. Okay, and so we shall begin with what is called review of set theory. Review of set theory, which means that we shall just take a quick review of elementary set theory, because that is something which we shall require fairly often. Okay, you are already familiar with what is known as say union or intersection of sets. So suppose you are taken given say two sets A and B, then you know what is meant by things like A union B or A intersection B or A minus B. Okay, this is perhaps may not be familiar to you. Let this means the set of all x in A with the property that x is not in B. Okay, x is in A and x is not in B. That is the set of all those x which are not in B. That is called A difference B. Okay, or A minus B. Now it is okay to write things like that when there are only two sets. For example, if there are three sets, you may write that as A union B union C. Or if there are n sets, you may write that as a1 union a2, etc. Okay, but suppose there are a large number of sets, say possibly infinite family of sets, then how do you write this? Okay, and so for that, what is done is that, let us take the case of, suppose instead of writing this a and b, suppose I take this as a1 and a2. Okay, then this 1 and 2, these are called indices. Okay, and so I will take the set I to be the set of indices. So this set consists of just 1 and 2. Okay, right. So instead of calling now a1 union a2, we write this as union ai, where small I belongs to big I. Okay, small I belongs to big I. Okay, now advantage here is that this I can be now any set. Okay, it need not consist of just two symbols here. So such a set, so now we can take I as any arbitrary set. This I is called indexing set. Okay, and so indexing set means what? It will consist of some indices. Okay, so a particular index will be denoted by small I in I. Okay, and what we are dealing with now is what is called a family of sets. That means for each index in this indexing set I, you have one particular set, and that set will denote by ai, and the whole family we may denote by this. Suppose a script f, that is family of the sets ai, that is a suffix I for each I, each small I in big I. So this is what is called family of sets. Family of sets, family of sets indexed by the indexing set big I. Okay. Now once we have such a family, then we can talk about various operations on that family of sets. Okay. So for example, one can talk of what is meant by union AI. So we can write now union AI, union taken over every small I in big I. Or similarly, if we want to talk of the intersection, for example, what will this mean? It will mean that the set of all those X such that X belongs to this AI for some I. Okay. For at least one small I in I. Similarly, we can talk of what is meant by intersection AI, small I in intersection taken over all those small I belonging to big I. So what will this mean? Instead of saying for some I, it will mean for all I. That is, this will be the set of all X such that X belongs to AI for all I in I. Okay. Yeah. By the way, let me again say, since this is the beginning lecture, let me say that this is symbol as usual stands for all, and similarly this stands for there exists. Standard symbols used in mathematics. Okay. Then once we understand these unions and intersections over an arbitrary family, then we can also imitate the various laws that we know about the intersections and unions about this finite family. For example, what we know here is that suppose you take say two sets A union B and take their union A union B, and suppose we take the intersection of this with C. Okay. Then what we know is that this is same as A union C intersection B union C. Okay. And so what we can say is that in a similar way, whatever is true for just union of two sets, similar thing is true for such a union, and a similar law for if you interchange intersection and union. Okay. Let us just mention one of them. So for example, suppose I want this union AI, union of AI, I belonging to I, and suppose I want to take the intersection of this whole thing with some other set C. Okay. Then this will be same as union over I, AI intersection C. Okay. Right. And this can be proved by usual elementary methods. Basically use this definition, what is meant by AI intersection C, what is meant, just use the definition of left hand side and right hand side. And similarly, you will get another law by interchanging the unions and intersections. Okay. In a similar way, suppose all these sets are a part of some big set. Suppose X is some set which contains every set here. Okay. Sometimes this is called universal set. Okay. Then we can talk of what is meant by complement of that. Okay. That is, we can, just as here we have dealt with A minus B. So similarly, one can talk of X minus A, X minus A. So this is sometimes called complement. Okay. And where we take the complement also, the so-called De Morgan's laws are also true in this case. Okay. Again, you would be familiar with De Morgan's laws when it comes to the union or intersection of two sets. A similar thing is true here. For example, what you know is this A union B, complement of that is the thing, but A complement intersection B complement. Okay. Okay. And similarly, suppose you take a arbitrary union like this, that is union AI, I belonging to I, then its complement. Okay. Its complement means X minus this. Okay. X minus this whole union AI, I, that will be same as intersection I belonging to I AI complement. Okay. AI complement. Now, okay. So that is about the unions, intersections, complements, etc. Another concept of the set theory that we use very often is what is called Cartesian product. Cross product. Okay. And what this means is, suppose you take two non-empty sets A and B, then this is something is familiar with you, this A cross B. It is nothing but the set of all ordered pairs of the form A comma B, where the small a belongs to big A and small b belongs to big B. Okay. Now that we are here with this notation, suppose we take B and A are same. Suppose we take A cross A, then we denote this by A square or A superscript 2. Okay. So quite the notations quite frequently used are the following. For example, R2, this is the thing, but R cross R. Okay, so this is the set of ordered pairs of real numbers. So this will be the set of all pairs of the form A comma B, where A and B both are real numbers. Okay. And similarly, one can define what is meant by R3 or R4. R3 will be R cross R2 or R2 cross R3, that does not matter. And in general, we can define what is meant by Rn. Okay. It will be R cross R, Cartesian product taken n times. Similarly, one can define A cross B cross, suppose there are n such sets, A1 cross A2 cross A3 cross an, we can define what is meant by Cartesian product of those n sets. The real problem occurs if we want to define the Cartesian product of an arbitrary family. Okay. That is, suppose now you are given a family like this Ai, for I belonging to I. Suppose this is the family. Okay. And suppose I want to talk of what is meant by the Cartesian products of sets in this family. Okay. So that is pi Ai, this is denoted by pi Ai, pi for the product, okay, pi Ai, I belonging to I. Okay. Okay. What is the meaning of this and how this is defined? Now to do that is a very non-trivial question, and for that we need to go to another concept from the set theory, namely that of functions. Okay. We will come back to this. We will first discuss something about functions, because this is defined in terms of functions. Okay. There is no simple way of defining this in terms of ordered pairs or ordered triples or ordered quadruples, etc., because this is an infinite family in general. Okay. Now let us just recall quickly that when you talk of a function, there are basically three things or three objects or three concepts in mind. Okay. Function. What are those three things? First is, there are two sets A and B, both are non-empty sets. Okay. That is, A and B both are non-empty sets. Okay. And f is a function which goes from A to B. F is a function which goes from A to B. So functions means these three things, two non-empty sets, and what is f? F is a rule. F is a rule which assigns to every element in A some unique element in B. Okay. That is a function. Okay. Let us take it like that. Okay. Of course, it is possible to define it in some other way, by as a some kind of subset of A cross B, etc., but let us not go into that right now. Okay. So this is a function. This set A is called domain of F, and this set B is called a codomain of F. Of course, the set A and B need not be different. Okay, those can be same also. So the function can go from A to A, and quite frequently in our real analysis course, the functions will go from either R to R or some subset of R to some subset of R. Okay. That is the thing. Now, given such a function, for example, let us just take some example. That is, when you take x in A, then fx, suppose I call this fx as y, y is equal to fx in B. Okay. I think I'll make a slight change in the notation here. That is very convenient. Instead of taking the sets as A and B, let me take the sets as big X and big Y. Big X and big Y. Okay, so that I can take this A and B as subsets of X and Y. Okay. So X belongs to X, Y is fx, that belongs to Y. Okay. So this big X is a domain and big Y is a codomain. Now, for any element X in X, small X in big X, this Y is equal to fx. This is called image of x. image of x. So x is called the object and y is called the image of x, okay. And so other way, if an element y, small y in y is given, then this x is called a pre-image, okay. X is called a pre-image of y, okay. X is called pre-image of y. Now it can happen that, of course, once from the definition of a function it follows that given an object small x in x, there will be a unique image, okay. But given an element small y in y, there can be several pre-images. That depends on what that function is, okay. And that determines certain properties of functions or certain definitions involving functions, okay. Now to make the idea somewhat clear, let us just take a couple of functions. And as I said, our most examples will come from functions which go from R to R or some subsets of R. Let us take it like that, okay. So let us say I will take one function f from R to R. Suppose here this function is something like this, fx is equal to, let us say, 3x plus 5. This is one function, okay. And I will take one more function g from R to R, and where gx is, let us say, x square, x in R, here also x in R, okay. Then we come to the general definition once again. These are just examples which will illustrate the concepts, okay. As I said right in the beginning, in order to understand any concept or any definitions, as soon as you learn a particular definition, you should also look at several examples which satisfy that definition, and also some examples which don't satisfy that definition, okay. Then only one will understand what is involved in that particular definition, okay. Now what are the definitions here that I am going to look at? First thing is, we will say what is meant by saying that f is 1-1, or also sometimes it is called, some books prefer to call it injective. This is means the same thing, okay. Okay, this means what I was saying just now, that if you are given an element small y in y, then that particular element may have one or more pre-images, okay. If it has only one pre-image, then it means that that function is called 1-1, okay. Right, that means given any y in y, there can exist at the most one x for which fx is equal to y, or which is same as saying that suppose you take two elements x1 and x2, and if fx1 and fx2 coincide, then x1 and x2 must coincide, okay. So we'll take it that way. F is said to be 1-1, okay, 1-1 or injective if for all x1 x2 in x, fx1 is equal to fx2, this implies x1 is equal to x2, okay. Okay, in fact this need not be said, okay. If x1 x2 if you take two elements x1 and x2 in x, and if it so happens that their images coincide, then those elements themselves must coincide, okay. So this must happen for whatever x1 and x2 is given, okay. For example, this function here, okay. If you take, say, suppose fx1 is equal to fx2, it will mean that 3x1 plus 5 is equal to 3x2 plus 5, and that will immediately lead to x1 is equal to x2. Whereas this function is not 1-1, because if you take, say, x is equal to plus 1 or x equal to minus 1, still gx will be same as 1, okay. So this is not a 1-1 function, okay. Okay, then another concept, what is said, f is said to be onto, what is meant by onto, or also some book, whichever books call this as injective, this is also called surjective. In simple language, it means that every element here has a pre-image, okay, every element here has a pre-image, okay. Is said to be onto if for every y in y, there exists x in x, such that f x is equal to y. Okay. Again, looking at these two functions here, this function is onto. Okay. Suppose you are given any y here, then it will mean that f x is equal to 3x. This will f x is equal to y. This will mean that 3x plus 5 equal to y, and you can easily solve this and write x as y minus 5 by 3. So that shows that f is onto. Okay. All right. Okay. No, this is not onto. This is not onto because, for example, suppose you take y equal to minus 1. Okay. Suppose you take y is equal to minus 1, then there is no x in R for which gx is equal to gx is equal to y. Okay. Right. Okay. If a function is both 1-1 and onto, okay, it is also sometimes called 1-1 correspondence. 1-1 correspondence. Okay, 1-1 correspondence, or it is also there another name for that is bijection. Bijection or bijective function. Okay. Function is called bijective function or just called bijection if it is both 1-1 and onto, which means for every element here, there is precisely one element here and vice versa. Okay. For every object, there is exactly one image, and for every image, there is exactly one pre-image. Okay. This is an example of bijection. Okay. This is both 1-1 and onto. Okay. This is neither 1-1 nor onto. Okay, one more concept which is related to this. We have talked of what is meant by domain of f and codomain of f. We should also say what is meant by range of f. Range of f. Okay. So range of f is nothing but it is the set of all images. Okay, it may or it may happen that every small y in y is image of something, but there may be some elements which are not images of this. Okay. So you exclude those elements, that is just collect set of all images, then that is called range of f. Okay. So what is range of f? There is, we can say it is the set of all elements of this form fx for x in x. Okay, or which is the same thing, we can say that you can set of those small y in y such that there exists x in x such that fx is equal to y. Okay. So this range of f, this is always a subset of the codomain. Okay. Range of f is always a subset of the codomain, and these two sets coincide if and only if f is onto. Okay. That is range. So we can say that f is onto if and only if range of f is equal to y. Okay, range of f is equal to y. In fact, that is the same thing said in different languages. Okay. Okay. Now, for example, if you look at this example here, what is the range of g here? Range of g is because it takes only non-negative values. So we can say the range of g is this 0 to infinity. Okay. Which is not same as R. Okay, which is not same as R. So this is not an onto function. Whereas the range of f is R, because range of f is R. Okay. Given any such set x or y, you can always define some functions. For example, I can define a function which is called I suffix x. Okay, I suffix x from x to x. This is called identity function on x. Okay, that means x goes to itself. What is meant by identity function on x? We can say that I suffix x applied to x is equal to x for x in x. Okay. Similarly, one can talk of what is meant by I suffix y. That will be a function which will go from y to y. Okay, and it will take every element of y to itself. Okay. Similarly, one can think of what is meant by constant function. Okay. What is a constant function? It suppose you take some element y not here. Okay. Send all elements in x to that fixed element y naught, that is a constant function. That will obviously not onto unless y contains just one point. Okay. Now when the function is both verbal and onto, or when the function is a bisection, then you can define a function which goes from y to x, which in a certain sense what is called inverse function. Okay, that is, so let us come back to this. So suppose f from x to y is a bisection. Okay, that means it is one and onto. Okay, what does it mean? It means that given any y, any small y in y, there exists a unique small x such that f x is equal to y. So suppose I call that x at some g of y. Okay, okay. Then so we can say that define f inverse from y to x as follows. Okay, from y to x as follows. Okay, let take y, take small y in y. Okay, then since first of all, since f is onto, okay, take y, since f is onto, there exists x in x such that f x is equal to y. Okay, all right. And since f is 1 this x is unique. Okay, you, there cannot be more than one x. Okay, so since f is 1 x is unique, such x is unique, x is unique. So define that x as inverse of y. Okay, define that x as inverse of y. Okay, define f inverse of y equal to x. Okay, f inverse of y equal to x. So this function f inverse from y to x, that is called inverse function. Okay, f inverse is called, this f inverse from y to x, this is called inverse function. We shall come to the properties of inverse function just in a moment. But before that, let us also come to one more concept which is very frequently used in analysis, and what is meant by composition of functions. Okay. Okay. And this is, here the idea is as follows. Suppose you have three sets x, y and z. Let us say all these three are non-empty sets. And suppose f is a function from x to y and g is a function from y to z. Okay. Suppose these two are functions. Okay, then we can compose these two functions and form a function which goes from x to z. Okay, that is, we suppose we call that function h, which is denoted as g composed with f. This will be a function which goes from x to y, sorry, x to z. Okay, and that is defined as follows. Okay, that is, suppose you take some small x here. Okay, then look at f of that. Look at f of that. Then that will be an element in y. Okay, and then apply g to that. Apply g to that. Then that will be an element in z. Okay, so you define that element as h of x. Okay, so what is h of x is g of f of x. That is called a composition. Okay. That is called a composition. So, and remember here that composition is not a commutative operation. That is, you can talk of g composed with f, but f composed with g may not be defined at all. Okay, if x, y, z, all three are different sets, then f composed with g may not have any meaning. Okay, it is also possible that g composed with f and f composed with g both are meaningful. Both can be defined. But still they can be different. Okay. So, okay. Now, coming back to this inverse function, what is the properties of this inverse function? It is the following. That is, suppose we compose F inverse with F. Okay. That is, F goes from x to y, and F inverse goes from y to x. So, suppose we look at, say, F inverse composed with F. F inverse composed with F. Is it clear that will go from x to x? Okay, because F takes a relevant x from x to y, then F inverse brings it back to x. Okay. Now, suppose you take x, it will be f x, and F inverse of f x. What will be F inverse of f x? By this definition, it will be same as x. So, in other words, F inverse composed with F is nothing but what we had called identity function on x. F inverse composed with F will be nothing but the identity on x. Similarly, if you look at F, now in this case, we can also compose this way, F composed with F inverse. This is also possible. Okay. Now, what happens? F inverse takes an element from y to x, and F brings back to y. Okay. So, this will be identity on y. This will be identity on y. Okay. So, again, you see, if x and y are different sets, F composed with F inverse and F inverse composed with F, those will be two different functions. Of course, both of those are identity functions, but identity functions on different sets. Okay. Now, related to this, there are a few more things. We also want to know, till now we have talked about what is meant by image of a point. Okay. We can similarly talk of what is meant by image of a set. Similarly, we can talk of what is meant by pre-image, or what is also known as more frequently as inverse image of a set. Okay. So, to do that, let us take some subset A of x. Okay. Then we talk of what is meant, so our f from x to y is a function. Now, given a subset A of x, we want to talk of what is meant by f of a. Okay. Now, this is clear how it is defined. You take all elements in A and take their images and collect. So, that will be a set, that will be a subset of y, that is called f of a. So, this is nothing but we will say set of all f of x such that x belongs to A. Or another way of saying that is, it is set of all those small y in y such that there exists x in A satisfying fx is equal to y. This is called image of A under F. Image of A under F. Okay. Similarly, one can look at, just as instead of taking a subset A of x, I can start from some subset B of y. Okay. So, I can start some subset B of y. Yeah, by the way, here A can be an empty set also, okay, in which case F of A also will be empty. Okay, because there will be nothing here. And okay, all right, before going to this, let me say there are a few obvious things about, for example, suppose you take two sets A1 and A2, then it something like this is clear, F of A1 union A2, that is same as F of A1 union F of A2, etc. Okay. And again, this is not necessary for any two sets, this is true for any, in general we can say this, okay, F of union I belonging to some indexing set I, this is same as union of F ai small I in big I. Okay. Small I in big I. Whereas, if it comes to intersection, we can say only this, F of intersection ai I in I, this is contained in intersection F A I, I belonging to I. Okay. But the two sets may not be equal. Okay. Two sets may not be equal, and one can give examples where the inequality, where this is properly contained in this. it's not very difficult to give those examples. Now let us come to the other concept. Just as here we have started with taking a subset A of x, now this time let us start from taking some subset B of y. Okay, so suppose B is a subset of y. Okay, then we define what is meant by the set of all pre-images of B, or also sometimes called inverse images of B, and that set is denoted by F inverse B. Of course, one should understand here is that we can talk of F inverse of B even though F inverse is not defined. Okay, remember F inverse is as a function is defined when F is 1 1 and onto. Okay, but we can define F inverse of B even when F is neither 1 1 nor onto, because this is a set. What is F inverse of B? It is the set of all pre-images, that is, it is a set of all x in X such that Fx belongs to B. That is, take all elements in B for which there is some pre-image, okay, set of all x and x such that Fx belongs to B. This is called inverse image. Okay, of course, if F inverse as a function exists, that will coincide with whatever we would mean by, because F inverse will be a function from y to x. And F inverse B will be have the same meanings, F inverse Y for Y in B. Okay, but this is defined even when F inverse does not, inverse image of a set is defined even when F inverse as a function may or may not be defined. Okay, and inverse images behave in a much better manner when we take unions and intersections. Okay, what is, okay, let me just state this property here. So suppose we look at properties something similar. For example, we would suppose we take a family of this, a family like this, so family Bi, where I in I, and each Bi is a subset of Y. Okay, each Bi is a subset of Y. Then we would like to say how these inverse images behave with respect to intersections and unions. So what we can say is the following: F inverse of union Bi, small I in I, this is same as union F inverse Bi, small I belonging to big I. Okay, and similar thing is true about the intersection. Okay, this is one property. Second property is the following: F inverse of intersection Bi, small I belonging to I, this is same as intersection of F inverse Bi, small I belonging to I. Okay, these are simple exercises. Okay, elementary set theory. Okay, just we have to look at the definition of both sides, see the properties of intersection, unions and their definitions, and show that if you take any element here, that belongs to here, and similarly if you take any element here, that belongs to the left hand side. Okay, all right. So that is about the elementary properties related to functions and subsets. Okay, now let me again remind you, why did we come to the discussion of functions? Because I said that if you want to define the product of infinite family of sets, you have to make use of the concept of functions. So where does that come into picture? Okay, so let us again come back to that question. So suppose this is a family. Okay, suppose script F is a family Ai, I belonging to I. Okay, and we want to define what is meant by product of Ai, product of all these sets small I in I. Okay, now let us look at the analogous thing about the finite sets, and what we shall do is that we shall rewrite or reinterpret our definition of the Cartesian product of two sets in a slightly different manner, and we shall observe that that different manner is capable of generalization here also. So suppose we had only two sets A1 and A2, then we would call A1 cross A2. Okay, we will call A1 cross A2. So what will be A1 cross A2? That will be the set of all elements of this form x1 x2, where x1 belongs to A1 and x2 belongs to A2. Okay, all right. Now suppose I want to imitate this, then here I cannot write pair or triple, or because I don't know how many of them are there, okay, right. It will be something like, this will depend on what this set I is there, okay. But what I can do is reinterpret this in the following manner. See, here there are two sets. So by indexing set here is I, that contains just two symbols, 1 and 2, okay, all right. And suppose I consider I interpret this x1, x2 as the values of a function, okay, as the values of a function. What function? It is a function which sends 1 to x1 and 2 to x2, okay. So that is, so we can say that that is a function. I will call that function f. It is a function, it goes from I to a1 union a2, okay, a1 union a2, okay. With what is the property? Property is the following, that is f1 belongs to a1 and f2 belongs to a2, okay. So this f1 is my x1 and x2 is nothing but f2, okay, right. So for each such pair x1, x2, I can say that there is a function f, says that first coordinate is f(1), second coordinate is f(2). Okay. So suppose I collect all such functions which have this property, okay. Suppose I collect all such functions which have this property, then I get all such coordinates here, okay. So that is nothing but the cross product, okay. But now this is a concept which is capable of, so let me just rewrite here, okay. What is this? This we can say that this is nothing but the set of all functions f from I to a1 union a2, but not all functions, okay. What should happen is that f(1) should be in a1 and f(2) should be in a2, okay. f(1) should be in a1, so satisfying this f(1) belongs to a1 and f(2) belongs to a2, okay. Now this is something which I can generalize here, okay. Okay, I cannot talk of pairs or triples or anything, but I can say that I will consider all those functions which go from this indexing set I to union of the family, union of the family which I already defined. And what should be the property? For each index I, f(i) should belong to that corresponding set A I, okay. So we will say this is the set of all f from I to union A I, I to union AI, satisfying f(i) belongs to a(i), and this for every I in I. Remember, that is what is happening here. This I contains only two symbols, 1 and 2. F1 belongs to A1, F2 belongs to A2. So here we don't know how many I's there. It can be 2, 3, n. Countable, infinite, or uncountable, anything, okay. So this should happen for every I. Any function which satisfies this, such a thing is called a choice function. Why choice function? Because it chooses one element for each I, it chooses, picks up an element from the corresponding set A I, okay. Now the whole question is, how do we know that such functions exist, okay. How do we know that such functions exist? And that is where we come to the basic foundations of set theory. As you know, in mathematics you have to start from some basic concepts, okay. In each subject there are some basic concepts which are called undefined terms. Like for example, if you want to define what is meant by set, and then you try to define that as a collection of objects, then somebody may ask what is a collection, then you go to define what is meant by collection, again you will have some other word which will have a similar meaning. So that way one end up in circles. So circularity of the argument. So in each discipline of mathematics there are some terms which are left undefined, okay. Those are basic terms. And similarly there are some axioms, okay, that is some things which are starting hypothesis or starting axioms. So in set theory we don't define what is meant by a set, or what is meant by an element, or what is meant by being a member of a set. We assume that those things are understood, okay. So the set theory similarly starts from some undefined terms and some axioms, okay. And that the choice functions exist is one of those axioms, okay. It is a very famous axiom, it is called axiom of choice, okay. I will just take this axiom of choice and then maybe with that we will stop for today. Okay. What is axiom of choice? It is the following. Okay. If the axiom of choice means the following, given a family, basically in simple words it simply means that choice function exists if each of this AI is non-empty. Okay. Given a family, AI, I belonging to I of non-empty sets, there exists a function, okay, we will call choice function. Okay. This is called choice function, then that is why this axiom is also called axiom of choice. Function f going from I to union AI, small I in I, such that f of I belongs to AI for every small I in I. Okay. Another way of saying the same thing is that what this means that if each of this AI is non-empty, at least one such function exists. That means if each of this AI is non-empty, this product is also non-empty. In fact, that is another way of stating axiom of choice, and that is also given very frequently in some books. So equivalently, we can say that if each AI is non-empty, then their product is also non-empty. Product AI I belonging to I is also non-empty, or in more simpler words, Cartesian product of a family of non-empty sets is non-empty. Okay. That is one version of axiom of choice. Okay, we'll stop with that.